Hi, welcome to this Accofina tutorial. Today we're talking about macroeconomic policy. We're going to give a very quick guide to macroeconomic policy through fiscal policy and monetary policy. Firstly, I want to apologize if you can hear construction noises in the background. I've got a building going up nearby and it's quite loud today, so I apologize if you can hear that. Okay, so what are we going to cover today? We're going to talk about why we have macroeconomic policies in society. We're going to talk about how we can classify different macro policy directions. Then we'll go into fiscal policy, monetary policy, and have a conclusion and wrap up. All right, so first up, why do we have macroeconomic policies in the first place? So business cycles have occurred for centuries. They generally began back in the 19th century, and they have occurred all the way to the most recent GFC and Great Recession. So between every 6 to 8 years, we often go through a boom and bust cycle. And these have repeating swings through prosperity, recession, depression, and recovery. Now, when we talk about boom and bust cycles, the economic indicators are generally changes in aggregate output, employment, prices, and national income. So that's like GDP and the unemployment rate, the inflation rate, and GNI or wages and business profits and so forth. We've had these repeating periods of booms and busts. And so our societies and civilizations have organized to minimize the impact of this disruptive volatility. And it doesn't take a lot to remember the GFC and how a lot of the world's population had a very difficult time adjusting to this business cycle. A lot of people lost their jobs, a lot of people lost their homes, incomes were low, wage growth has been low since, the recovery has been slow, and that's just one example. It's been hard on on the people of the world. So our societies have organized. And in modern times, we've designated two main institutions that aim to minimize the negative impact of business cycles. Now we've designated governments to help out with the business cycle, and they do this through fiscal policy. And we've also created the concept of central banks, and they operate monetary policy. So what are the goals of macroeconomic policy? This is kind of in colloquial terms, rather than technical terms, but we just want to try and make the good times last. We want extended periods of high, stable, and ever-growing prosperity. And on the flip side, we want to ease the difficulty of the bad times. We want to shorten periods of recession and minimize the need for harsh and abrupt adjustments of its citizens. So kind of we want to have soft landings. It's when we have to do things major and very quickly that it's very hard for the population to adjust and causes a lot of friction and unhappiness. So why do we have these macroeconomic policies? To sum up, we have them to improve the quality of life of citizens. A lot of people believe it's simply just about making money and business and the economy. It's just simply about everyone getting rich or certain people getting rich. But the genesis of most macroeconomic policies is to improve the quality of life of all citizens. How successful they are, I'll let you debate, but they are the aims. Okay. So how can we classify macro policy directions? Now we're getting to some of the more technical stuff. Now we'll either classify macro policies as expansionary or contractionary, or even neutral. Now expansionary policies encourage economic growth. They try to combat deflation when prices are falling, or disinflation if it is accelerating too quickly. And disinflation is when inflation is slowing down. Well, inflation is still occurring, but it's occurring at a slower and slower rate. And we'll also try and boost employment and national income through expansionary policies. Well, technically, what these policies are trying to do is increase aggregate demand in the economy. All right, so let's go to contractionary. This time we're trying to slow, moderate, or stabilize economic growth. And we could also combat rising inflation and its negative impact. Now, I'm not going to go into the specific negative impacts of rising inflation, other than saying that they are very, very pervasive. And sometimes we have to moderate employment growth. We've destabilized wage growth or the inflation that is caused by wage growth. And it's the opposite to last time, we're trying to decrease or moderate aggregate demand in the economy. But this is an important note. The goal isn't just to kill the party. The macro policy isn't trying to make less people employed or less people wealthy or slow the good times. The goal is to attack the risks of inflation and possibly even hyperinflation and minimize the chance of an epic bust. Now, I'm sure a lot of us have heard the old saying, the bigger the boom, the bigger the bust. So if things get out of control and we have a huge boom, then we might have an even bigger bust, which will be even harder to adjust to when things eventually do correct. And as I mentioned, inflation can be very pervasive in our economy. It can destroy wealth. It can misallocate resources. We've probably seen some countries that have had hyperinflation, whether it's historically in Germany or in modern times in Venezuela, where economies really do fall apart when hyperinflation kicks in. We can't ignore neutral policy. Now, neutral policies is kind of like when policy setters think that we're either in a sweet spot in the economy or what's termed a Goldilocks economy, after that old fairy tale where it's not too hot and not too cold, or we may just be in an uncertain period. And policy setters kind of want to wait and see before they make their next move. So they may wait a few months or a few quarters, see how the economy tracks or what previous decisions, how they impact the economy, and then they'll make their next move. Now, neutral fiscal policy is when this period's deficit or surplus is equal to last period's deficit or surplus. So there's no aggregate change in taxes or expenditure, or the balance of them. Now, neutral monetary policy is when the policy rate is equal to the neutral rate. Now, the neutral rate is real GDP at the trend growth rate plus the target inflation rate. And that's the formula for the neutral rate in regards to monetary policy. All right, so let's get into the policies. What are the policy levers for fiscal policy? That's right, it's taxes and spending, which is a famous phrase you've probably heard of many times. So when we talk about taxes, we're talking about revenue. So revenue raised by the government that forms part of fiscal policy. Now, they can have direct taxes on income and wealth. So there we're talking about our income tax or our company tax or even death duties or inheritance taxes in regards to wealth, or even capital gains tax in regards to Australia's circumstances. Now, also there can be indirect taxes on goods and services, and here you'll find your VATs in Europe or your GSTs in Australia and India. Okay, so the other side of the equation in regards to fiscal policy levers are spending, that is expenditure. Now, governments can introduce transfer payments, and these are just cash payments to citizens to redistribute wealth within the economy. Other than that, governments can have current spending. This is when governments pay for goods and services to fund the government itself and its services. Defense spending or health spending or federal education spending or state education spending. These are your current spending categories. And finally, there's capital spending. And this is when we fund infrastructure or other long-term assets to boost the economy. They're things like governments building railroads, or in Australia's case, governments building the national broadband network, or things like airports, ports, and similar sorts of things. It can also include more intangibles, like if government invests in research and development, that could possibly lead to breakthroughs in particular technologies. But just remember, the three main expenditure items are transfer payments, current spending, and capital spending. All right, so how do we implement an expansionary policy? In this case, we would increase expenditure or decrease taxes or both. What we're doing is increasing the deficit or reducing the surplus and thus increasing economic activity. So if the government increases expenditure, it's spending more, and this would increase economic activity. Or if it simply decreases taxes while maintaining the same level of expenditure, so less money has been taken from households and firms, they can continue to spend and it won't be locked up in government coffers. And thus, that would also increase economic activity. And the opposite is for implementing contractionary policy. You would decrease expenditure, or you would increase taxes, or you would do both. And again, the opposite would result. You would reduce the deficit or increase the surplus, and this would decrease economic activity. So if the government spends less, or if the government taxes more without having a commensurate increase in expenditure, then that would slow down the economy, as there would be less spending, less expenditure in the economy, less aggregate demand, and less economic activity. All right, so let's move on to monetary policy. What are the policy levers? Interest rates. Interest rates are the policy levers, and the central bank influence interest rates often through the money supply. So how are interest rates and the money supply altered? So a central bank can set a policy rate and say, this is what banks are charged when borrowing central bank reserves. So private bank can often borrow central bank reserves at attractive rates, which they can then on-lend to businesses and households, or firms and households. Obviously, the higher the rate, the less attractive it will be for those banks to borrow from the central bank reserves. Now, central banks can also conduct open market operations, and this is where they buy and sell government securities for cash. And finally, they can set the required reserve ratio. They can determine how much banks need as reserve. And if banks need those reserves, they can't lend it. And this in turn affects the deposit expansion multiplier, which impacts aggregate demand in the economy. So how do we implement an expansionary monetary policy? In this case, we need to increase the money supply. And assuming a stable money demand, interest rates will decrease. And when interest rates decrease, borrowing and expenditure becomes more attractive, and this should hopefully increase economic activity. The impact is increased borrowing, and as a result, increased economic activity. All right, so these are the technical... These are how an expansionary policy would be implemented. Firstly, the central bank would decrease the policy rate. They can make it easier for banks to borrow from central bank reserves. So a lower policy rate encourages banks to borrow from central bank reserves and on-lend to households and firms. Secondly, the central bank could buy securities in open market operations. So the central bank could hand over money to the banks and other participants, which they can then on-lend. So they take the piece of paper, the security, they hand over the cash, and the cash is on-lend and multiplies throughout the economy. And finally, it could reduce the required reserve ratio. Central bank reduces the level of reserves needed to be held by banks, then these new excess reserves can be on-lend. And that's kind of self-explanatory. So if banks don't need to hold 10% of their liabilities in cash, but perhaps only 5%, then that other 5% can then be relent to other households and firms. So how can we implement a contractionary monetary policy? And again, this is just the opposite. We would decrease the money supply, and assuming stable money demand, interest rates would increase. This would decrease borrowing, because borrowing is now more expensive with higher interest rates, and this would decrease economic activity. And implementing it is the exact opposite to earlier. So you would increase the policy rate, or you would sell securities in open market operations, or you would increase the required reserve ratio for banks. All right, so what did we cover today? We explained why we have macroeconomic policies in the first place, and that's to improve the population's quality of life. Specifically, employment, stable prices, and the general well-being of the community. How can we classify macro policy directions? We can say they're expansionary and contractionary. And don't forget, they can also be neutral. We talked about fiscal policy, which is taxes and spending, revenue and expenditure, and we talked about monetary policy, which is affecting economic activity through altering interest rates through the money supply. Okay, that's it. I hope it helped. Best of success with your studies and learning. If you enjoyed the video, please subscribe to this channel. You can click on a button that will soon appear or may have already appeared. You can watch another one of my tutorials now, or if you don't want to do those, I'd really appreciate a like. And finally, feel free to comment below if anything needs clarification or if you just want to say hello. As I always say, or try to always say, this doesn't have to be a one-way conversation. Often I can explain things better in written word when I have more time to think about it, as opposed to speaking directly into a microphone on the spot. So feel free to say hello or ask anything. Okay, that's it.